We wanted to make sure we've captured voices of Vermont students so that we can think about, okay, well, what do we use from this opportunity to move forward?
It's just such a danger, and it's so classic that we go now to what's the to-do list and not what did we feel and experience and learn, which will is exactly what needs to bring us back to community, to share the trials as well as the joys. And so I'm hopeful that schools find ways to make sure that space happens, honoring what clearly is a level of pain.
I think we talked mainly about mental health and how, like a large percentage of students were unsure if they could, get help from their schools. So I think that was something that really hit home for a lot of us, as well as some of the quotes were super powerful.
Yeah, I was in Anna's group, and I just kind of wanted to piggyback off what she just said, in that the things that we were noticing about the survey were that at sometimes even pre-COVID school wasn't that great. So in thinking about mental health, we were noticing that there were changes could be made in not just rebuilding pre-COVID school, but also improving it. So we talked about strategies like starting school later, because one of the great assets of online school was that we had more time to sleep in and make our own schedules, get to work and stuff. So, yeah, just working on carrying the positive things forward and improving on the system that we had before.
Personalized learning has really continued to prove itself as a vital piece of education, especially when the way the education structure changes. John said he was at a non-traditional program, helping students. I mean, John, you can definitely elaborate on this better than I can, I think. But the way that he was helping students basically stayed the same. It just the way that it looked changed. He was still having conversations with students, but now it might be, he's FaceTiming a student on a walk instead of walking with them. And Meg touched on being a science teacher, and trying to incorporate more math, kind of like interconnected learning instead of just her subject to help connect with her students.
Thanks, Galen. That was right on. The other thing that I drew from our conversation that I'm really interested in is how much students are identifying the need to connect with each other and how much that's connected to their holistic mental health experience, their holistic success in school, no matter how that school is happening. And it got me thinking about on whose terms are those opportunities created? I have check-ins at the beginning of every class that I teach, and we have an opportunity to build communities to speak to each other, but that's still like occurring in an official space led by an adult. And I don't know where the less structured, more incidental, more peer-focused interaction is happening in schooling. Right now, and it connects too, I think, to the experience of folks saying I'm on the screen all day, right? Because you don't have those interspersed breaks in between the more official space to connect on your own terms. So I don't know if that should occur in remote schooling, or if it should occur somewhere else, and remote schooling should get out of the way, or I don't know, but I'd be interested to hear more. But that was a cool thing that came out of our conversation.
I'll say one thing that I think about along with the reimagining the schedule is also reimagining who are the facilitators and the teachers. As someone who's been doing personalized learning for so long, I mean, sort of how do we bring the community in and letting kids, students sort of say, oh, this is what we would like as an elective, and then finding who might be willing to do that. So turn it around rather than the teachers saying, oh, this is the elective I want to teach. Let the kids, and then anyways, I think I said that first.
I really like that, and I feel like that's such a good point, like, it's like for so long it's been like teachers saying I want, like, teachers having the idea and having students go with it, and like maybe it could be a balance of also students having the idea and teachers going with it. And it's also like, you know, like the balance of it, because it's like it shouldn't all be like one way, and like figuring out, yeah, that's really a point.
Yeah, we use a metaphor at Up for Learning, or the teeter-totter. And, you know, in what we see often in our schools is, you know, that it's more of an adult dominated, the adult has their 2 feet on the ground, but the youth are kind of along for the ride, you know, and or they're disengaged. You know, along for the ride can feel like a lot of things. It's disengaged, it's checked out, it's also just passive, you know, so we need to have all 4 feet on the ground to make a real balance, as you said, Mira and Deborah, and think about it in a different way. So these are all the things we knew pre-COVID, right? COVID just really put the spotlight on them.
I'd just add that as somebody who's been working in an educational model where student co-created curriculum is the only way that we do things, I can't imagine doing it differently. Helping learning be meaningful is so necessary. And what's meaningful to me is different from what's meaningful to you. When you have a set of skills that you want somebody to walk away with, the way in which you reach those skills, when you have flexibility around that and you solicit student input, the outcomes are just so much more significant. So if some of you are thinking like, could we do that? You can. And once you do, you're not going to want to do it differently.
When the pandemic hit, prior to the pandemic, everyone was like, we can never do telemedicine. We can't work from home. Like, and we did, because we had to. So when we get these systems that are like, well, we can't do that, it's like, yes, we can. Like, we need to push through some of that, like, thinking that it can't be done. So let's do that.